have a very special guest with me, Mr. Mike Vale. Is it formerly of the Shondells and now of Crystal Blue Band?
You are exactly right, Arnie. How are you, buddy?
I'm good. How about you, Mike?
Good to see you. Yeah, we're the new. The name of the former Shondells is now the Crystal Blue Band, and there's a whole lot of mystique as to why that's all happened. But we'll get into that.
Okay. One question I want to ask, and you may not be able to answer this, but how did the Shondells get the name Shondells? I had read a story recently that it was because of Troy Shondell, singer who did This Time, who recently passed away. Do you know whether that's true or not?
It is true. Tommy James was from the same area as Troy Shondell, the Niles, Michigan area. And he grew up loving Troy and all his music. And when he put the band together, it was obvious that all of the groups around the country were the Hondell, what else was there? It was everything ended in Dells. That's all I remember.
Okay.
And he thought that, if we're going to pick a name like that, I'd just as soon have Shondell because of my favorite singer, Troy Shondell. So that's how it ended up happening.
Okay, well, that's something that I did not know. And after Troy passed away, and I think that's been within the last 2 months,
right.
Somebody had told me that that's how the Shondells got their name, and I didn't know that.
Yep, that's correct.
Okay, tell us about the new band, Crystal Blue Band.
Oh, yeah, that's exciting. What has occurred is that when the Shondells broke up back in 1970, 71, we were with Tommy for 4 or 5 years, had a lot of big hits, as you know. But then he ended up having to take time off from the road. He wasn't feeling well, and he ended up also going out on a solo career. So the Shondells then became Hog Heaven, if you remember, and we had a few modest hits and went on our way, and we each developed new careers after that besides music. I started a manufacturing firm that makes missiles for the government. Ronnie ended up in commercial work with Walmart, being in charge of traffic. Eddie built a recording studio and has done that for many years. But just a few years ago, when all of our commitments to our family and all our kids had grown up and gone and our jobs had got behind us, we decided, you know, it would be nice to put the band back together and go out and play music. Not only for ourselves, but there's a lot of people out there that want to hear the people who really made the songs, not a bunch of guys who call themselves the Shondells or call themselves any other major name, but the people who actually did it. And so we feel there's a market out there for us, but we ended up in a real battle for the name Shondells. I won't get into all the grimy detail of that, but let's just say it was not pretty. And we had to come up with a new name. Well, Eddie Gray and myself were co-writers on Crystal Blue Persuasion. So we thought in order to stay safe and away from lawsuits and everything else that could happen in this ugly business sometimes, we decided that we would pick a name that we developed ourselves, and that's the Crystal Blue Band. So that's what we are, that's who we are, and we will have our first show on June the 18th this year. It's going to be down in Pittsburgh at a place called the New Hazlitt Center for the Performing Arts. It holds about 500 people, and the tickets are on sale right now, and they're going crazy. They've been on sale for 2 days, and it's a third sold out already. So we have an exciting time coming up.
Now, have you performed at all? I know you did the Thanksgiving Day Parade, I believe it was,
right,
in Pittsburgh.
Right.
And the three of you actually got to sing because I've seen a video of that.
Right.
But have you been out on stage at all doing anything?
No, this is all why we're so excited about the June 18th, because it's our first full concert. Now, we've done other things. And for instance, every year, I've got a golf tournament, a benefit for my daughter who passed of leukemia, and this is lupus, this is a fundraiser for that, and we have all of the musicians that come in from Pittsburgh area, John Angel and the Halos and Norm Nardini and Billy Price, and everyone supports it, and we perform there, but that's only two or three songs and just to have a little fun, but we have not done a full concert. So what we ended up doing is, Eddie has, as I mentioned, has a recording studio. We went in the recording studio and we re-recorded all of our hits. This way we wouldn't be obligated for payment of royalties to other people. We could just do it ourselves. And we are ready to go now. We've got a full album ready to be released, and that will be sold also at the show in Pittsburgh.
Okay, we are going to do something very drastic right now. Oh. We get a chance to do or play one of the songs, and this will be the very first time it's been aired on radio. Is that correct?
You're absolutely right. You've got a world exclusive on you.
I like that. I do that every so often. Trade Martin does that with me every so often. I don't know whether you remember Trade or not, but he will send me some things. And we get to do an exclusive, and we are going to do one right now. And this is a song that you and Eddie wrote, is that correct, Crystal Blue Persuasion?
Yes, Eddie and I were the co-writers on Crystal Blue Persuasion, as well as some of the other songs on the album, right.
Okay, tell us a little bit of history about the song. At one point, everybody thought that it was a drug song, and it's not.
Right. Yeah, I get a kick out of how everyone has their own imagination and puts meaning into what you do. And that's fun because, you know, when you tell people just enough to let them draw their own conclusions, it's always interesting to see what happens and what comes out of it. But you're right. Everyone thought it was about drugs. In fact, Breaking Bad dedicated a whole episode to the drug use while playing Crystal Blue Persuasion behind the scenes. As you heard the music coming across, they closed their whole season with a show that they played the entirety of Crystal Blue Persuasion while they were doing drugs, making drugs. So that proved what most people thought it was about, even the industry. However, it was not that at all. Crystal Blue Persuasion came about from a phrase that we heard a young man mention. We were at a concert in Atlanta, and there was an opening band playing with us that night, and we were in the dressing room, and we were talking about the peace movement of the day. Everyone was marching against war and just doing all they could to promote peace, and a lot of the music was dedicated to that back then too. And one of the young kids in that in the back room of that concert mentioned the fact that when he looked around the world and saw all the peace movement that was going on, it was like a crystal blue persuasion coming across the world. And he said that that's what's going to lead to peace. And when he mentioned those words, Tommy and I looked at each other and says, wow, what a phrase. Let's do something with that. So sure enough, the next day we went, got our guitar and sat down and started to write Crystal Blue Persuasion, which we finished in about 2 or 3 days. It just came together so beautifully. But and Eddie was there, too. He helped write it.
Now, with everybody thinking that there was the drug relationship, did you have any problems with the FCC over getting it played?
No, because they were only worried about the obvious. When something like a phrase like Crystal Blue Persuasion, which could mean anything, comes along, they don't worry about that. They let everyone use their own judgment. But if you say something, we had more trouble with I Think We're Alone Now. Boston banned I Think We're Alone Now because it had sexual implications. When you tumble to the ground and whatever you were doing, they wouldn't play the song. So that tells you what a difference in attitude there were from back in the 60s to now.
Well, I'm going to have to do a show sometime on banned songs because there's just so many of them. It's right. Unbelievable.
That's right.
Okay, well, if you would do the honors of introducing for the world to hear for the very first time the Crystal Blue Band's version of Crystal Blue Persuasion, we want to do it.
I would be happy to do that. Very excited to introduce Ron Rossman singing the lead on this song. It was performed in Eddie Gray's studio in Scottsdale, Pennsylvania. And it's the song that Eddie Gray and I, along with Tommy James, wrote back in 1968. I hope you like Crystal Blue Persuasion.
Most definitely.
Crystal Blue Band and a brand new release of Crystal Blue Persuasion. That sounds awfully good, Mike.
Thank you. Yeah, we worked hard on that, and I'm very proud of what we ended up with. It's great.
Mr. Mike Vale of the Crystal Blue Band, our special guest. Yeah. And it seems strange to say that as after saying the Shondells for so many years.
Yeah, well, we have to start something all new now, but it's going to be just as great.
I think so. And the way the Crystal Blue Persuasion sounded is awfully good.
Thank you. Tell us
about Sugar on Sunday.
Yeah, that's another one of the songs we re-recorded. I think we have 12 of our hits on the new album that's coming out. By the way, it's done. All we got to do is get it printed up. It will be ready for our concert in June. But anyhow, Sugar on Sunday was a song that I wrote for our Crimson and Clover album. It was pulled off of the album by a group called The Click, and they had a big hit with it. I think it was top 10 in the country, if I'm not mistaken. But I was so upset about the fact that they... took the song and made a hit out of it, because I wanted that to be one of our A-sides to one of our own releases. But we were having so much success back then, and trying to find out what the best song was to follow up a hit that you had, we were tripping over ourselves saying, well, this is better than that, and this is better than that. And we had so many good songs like Sweet Cherry Wine and Crimson and Clover and Crystal Blue Persuasion and Money Money and all those songs that just followed up one another, the trying to fit Sugar on Sunday in as a single release became very difficult. So we sort of missed the ball on that, and someone else jumped in and took it and made a big hit out of it. And I wasn't upset about it because my royalties are being paid either way, but I would have liked to have our name on it.
Well, didn't Tommy produce a click?
Yes, he did. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Seemed like a little bit of a conflict of interest.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. No, it wasn't the click that he produced. It was Alive and Kicking.
Oh, okay, Tighter and Tighter.
Tighter and Tighter.
Okay.
Yes, no, the click was out of Texas.
Okay, you're right.
Yeah.
I was thinking that he had something to do with that, but no, you didn't have anything to do with Alive and Kicking, did you?
No, I was not involved. I was there. I was in the studio, but I didn't do any production or anything on that.
Okay, before we get into Sugar on Sunday, tell us more about the concert. When's it going to be, and where can you get tickets?
Okay, I'll tell you a little bit about the concert, but before I do, I'll give you 10 seconds or 15 seconds to go get yourself a pen and pencil, because I'm going to give you the address that you can go to online and purchase tickets in a minute here. But anyhow, the event is on June 18th. We will be at the New Hazlitt Theater Center for the Performing Arts. It's in the north side of Pittsburgh. The show will feature Johnny Angel and the Halos. And if you have seen Johnny Angel and the Halos, I got a feeling that you aren't going to miss this. If you haven't seen them, you got to be there anyhow, because this is a great, great show band out of Pittsburgh, and they're in such demand. And the fact that they were willing to open up this show for the Crystal Blue Band just makes it all the more great for us. Anyhow, we're looking forward to it. It's going to be starts at 7 o'clock, and it'll be about a 2 or 3 hour performance. They're going to do about an hour, and we're going to do about an hour with the intermission in between. Be a lot of our product for sale there. We'll have our new album for sale there, and some of our solo albums that we've done over the years will be available. And even Hog Heaven, that the group that made some music right after we left Tommy James, will have those CDs there. So there'll be a lot to do. But if you want to go, get your pencil and paper out. You want to go online to ShowClicks, that's spelled ShowClix, ShowClix.com, ShowClix.com. And when you get to ShowClicks, there'll be a page that comes up, and it'll say Search Events. What you do is you put the Crystal Blue Review in that box. The Crystal Blue Review, spelled R-E-V-U-E. If you type that into the box, it'll take you to another page. You click on the Crystal Blue Review, and it'll take you to the ticket page where you can buy tickets. You don't want to miss this. It's going to be a great night. Our first concert together in 45 years. So, and it won't be the last, but you got to catch the first one. It's always most exciting if you do that. Go to showclicks.com and get your tickets today.
Okay, there's one person that you haven't talked about yet. You know that.
Mr. Eddie Gray?
No. Oh. Your new drummer.
Oh, Mike Wilps, of course. My goodness, thank you so much, Arnie. He would have a heart attack if he knew I didn't mention him. We lost Pete Lucia, who was the drummer for the Shondells, back in 87, I believe it was. He died at a very young age of 35 or 36 years old. He had a heart attack while playing golf, and if I've got to go sometime, I wouldn't mind going that way. But we lost a very brilliant drummer. We had no idea in the world we could get to take his place. But we have a friend here in the Western Pennsylvania area who is a fabulous drummer, and who plays on all of the songs that we're playing right now, all of the new stuff that we recorded. His name is Mike Wilps, and he's just a fantastic guy, and he will be a part of our show on June 18th at the New Hazlitt Theater.
Okay, and is there a website that you would like to mention?
Yes, go to the crystalblueband.com website, and you will see all kind of good stuff on there.
Okay, well, time for you to play disc jockey again.
Okay, here
and
we go.
If you would introduce Sugar on Sunday, we're going to go ahead and play your version for our listening audience.
All right. We will be hearing Mr. Mike Vale singing lead on this song. And Mr. Mike Vale, I believe, would like to see another opportunity to make a hit out of this by ourselves rather than the click. So you play it, Arnie, and give everybody a chance to make up their own mind. I think you're going to like Sugar on Sunday by the Crystal Blue Band.
Oh, the night is slipping away. I'm jolly, I'm jolly. And there's still so much left to say. I'm jolly, I'm jolly. But we haven't got time. I'll be gone in the sunshine. Oh, my love, you've been good to me. Them jolly, them jolly. I could love you so easily. Them jolly. But what can I do now? Hey, I'm telling you now. I am only sugar on Sunday. Leave it on Monday. Only got one day to love me, yeah. Sugar on Sunday. I'm leaving on Monday. But I'll be a we haven't got time. I'll be gone in the sunshine. I'm only sugar on Sunday. Leave it on Monday. Only got one day to love me, yeah. Sugar on Sunday. I'm leaving on Monday. But I'll be a
Crystal Blue Band and Sugar on Sunday. Very nice sounding song, and it has commercial potential.
I think so too. It was good enough back then, and I think it's even better now.
Mr. Mike Vale of the Crystal Blue Band, our special in-studio guest.
Yes, sir.
And it's always nice to have you in studio with me.
Oh, it's great.
And
enjoy it.
I know that Christmas time, you are always one of my guests for the Christmas extravaganza.
I always enjoy that. That's fantastic.
Now, I know that your former singing partner is coming to Greensburg on, June 18th or June 19th? It's a Friday.
We're on the 18th in Pittsburgh. So
it would be the 17th.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. That's what I understand. Well, I'm glad you brought that up. I'll tell you why. My emails and my messages and my phone has been ringing off the hook, wanting to know if the Pittsburgh Shondells or the Greensburg Shondells, Mike Vale and Ron Rossman and Eddie Gray, are going to be at that Palace show. And I'm so tired of answering the question because it's just taken all my time. I'm hoping that maybe as far out as you reach on this great radio station that we'll answer a lot of people at the same time. No. We are not going to be at that show. It's Tommy has a bunch of young kids who he now calls the Shondells. They're good, and you'll enjoy them. But for all of you who bought tickets to see us, you wasted your money. If you bought them to see Tommy, you haven't wasted your money. He's going to do a good job. But we will not be there. But we are going to be in Pittsburgh the following night, as I mentioned before. So go to showclicks.com and get your tickets.
Now, do you have any other shows in the works other than the one in Pittsburgh? Or?
Yes, there are several in Pittsburgh that we're working on in the Pittsburgh and Ohio area that I'm not at liberty to talk about yet because we haven't signed the deals. But what's going to happen on this first show, Arnie, is that we are going to video this first show. It's a very nice room. It holds about 500 people. It's like a New York-style little amphitheater, great seats all around. You can't get a bad seat in it. So we're going to use that opportunity to videotape the entire show and use that videotape for promotion, send it across the country to promoters and so forth. And that's going to really help us in getting the word out about us because people do not know at this point that we even exist, let alone what we're doing. But that's how we're going to get most of our shows. But even word of mouth right now, we've got about four or five things in the works. And we'll be announcing them as they happen. Can't wait to talk about it.
Yeah, we're looking forward to it. Yep. Now, I don't think that most people realize how proficient of a songwriter that you are. How many songs have you written that have gone basically top 40? Any idea?
Gone top 40? I would say 6 or 7 because, you know, that's a big number to reach. I mean, top 40 is a huge number. So when I say 6 or 7, it might not sound like very many, because I've actually written hundreds of songs, and a lot of them have charted, but not in the top 40 range. For instance, Della Reese did a couple of my songs, and they weren't top 40, but they climbed very high. And other songs, too, that I've written have done a good job, but mostly the top 40 is 6 or 7 songs.
And those are all the Tommy James songs?
Yes, but the ones that we've redone, too. Don't forget that our songs have been re-recorded. We probably hold the record for having the most number one songs by other artists on songs that we had number one ourselves and wrote.
Tiffany with I Think We're Alone Now.
That's right, and Billy Idol with Moni, and who else? Joan Jett with Crimson and Clover, and just Santana redid Crystal Blue Persuasion, and Prince redid Crimson and Clover. It's just a huge number of hits. So, we are very privileged. In fact, we hold a record that probably will never be broken. During 1 week, about 25, 30 years ago, there were two songs, number one and number two in the country, that were both covered by our hits. And they were Billy Idol and Joan Jett that were number one and two in the country 20 years after we wrote and recorded the same songs. That'll never happen again.
Okay, speaking of which, what was your impression of Billy Idol's Money Money, and or just Billy Idol in general?
That's a whole story, and a lot of that story I cannot tell right now.
Okay.
I think I told you how he came up choosing the Money Money to re-record that song, but I can't tell that to your listeners. My impression, he made it a party song. It was like Billy Idol in his basement with 20 friends. That's what it amounted to. So I enjoyed it for what it was. I didn't think it had the production qualities that ours did, but I think it was great, and it sure was nice to see it go back up the charts.
Well, too bad you didn't get the songwriting credits on that one.
That's right. Wrong place at the wrong time.
Okay, well, got time to do one more song, and tell us about I Think We're Alone Now.
Yeah, I Think We're Alone Now. I Think We're Alone Now has very good and very bad memories for me. And people might say, how in the world could a number one song in the country have bad memories for you? And I'll tell you how. When we did our early hits, right after our initial hit was Hanky Panky, we were under the influence and under the control of other writers and other producers. We had people like Bo Gentry and Richie Cordell who were sort of had us, everything that we did, they wrote and they produced, and we were just along for the ride making music. And I'm very thankful for the stuff that they came up with because it got us to where we were. But I was much happier when we got to the point where we were writing and producing for ourselves. For instance, in the Crimson and Clover album, we did all of it ourselves, and I took such pride in that. But getting back to your question, I Think We're Alone Now was written by Richie Cordell, Bo Gentry and Richie Cordell. They are the guys that are primarily responsible for keeping our careers going between Hanky Panky and the Crimson and Clover album, which we did. And this is one of the biggest songs that we had, and it's called I Think We're Alone Now, and it was redone, I think, by Tiffany, if I'm not mistaken. Also went to number one. So, and this is Ron Rossman and I singing I Think We're Alone.
Okay, before we get into that, I want to ask one other question that I don't think I've ever asked you this before, and I hate to put you on the spot, but reading Tommy's book about the mob influences, did you as a singer, as part of it, feel any of the pressure of the mob being involved with the group?
Oh, yes. In many ways, I felt pressure. And by the way, I've been on the spot before, so you haven't been, you're not putting me on the spot. In many ways, I felt it. The way I felt it most personally was that Morris Levy, who was in charge of the Genovese family, who owned Roulette Records, was the guy who paid us. And any time, and he didn't only pay us for our sales, he paid the writers and through his publishing company. And when I was going into his office on a monthly or bi-monthly basis saying, Morris, you know, I haven't seen any money from you for a while. I really need some cash. And looking him in the eyes and seeing that smirk on his face like, you know, get your butt out of here or they'll carry it out, that's when I felt it the most, because I knew that I was actually begging for something that I shouldn't be begging for. I should have had that without asking. That's how I felt it the most. But the other, there's a positive side to it, though, also, and that is that Morris Levy and his conglomerates, the underworld conglomerates, I should say, had big influence back then. So even though our songs were strong enough to speak for themselves, sometimes you need that influence to get people to play your song initially. And they had that influence, and they got it done. So there's good and bad. I remember both of them, and I'll be thankful for what I had back then.
Okay, one other thing I need you to mention before we play the song. Tell us about the golf tournament.
Oh, yes. Every year, as I mentioned before, we have a golf tournament in Murraysville, Pennsylvania, and it's in memory of my daughter, Tracy, who passed of lupus. It's for the Lupus Foundation. And it's a very unique golf tournament. This year, it's going to be on September the 19th. So if you're interested in golf and a good time, mark that on your calendar, September 19th. It's in Meadowink Golf Course in Murraysville. And it's unique in the fact that we not only have a great golf tournament with a lot of celebrities, all of the Pirates and the some of the Steelers come in, Bill Mazeroski and all the old-timers come in, and Elroy Face and... just some fabulous names. But in addition to that, after the golf tournament, we have prizes and dinner, and then all the heavyweights come in, all the rockers. Norm Nardini brings his band in. Johnny Angel brings the Halos in. Billy Price, the great soul singer from Pittsburgh, comes in. Donna Groom from the Beaumont and the Skyliners fame comes in. And we party all night. We have a great jam session, and... you got to get a hold of this thing. It's called the Tracy Vukish Memorial Golf Outing, and it's on September 19th. If you have any questions about it or if you're interested, you can go to my Facebook page, which is Mike Vale, and just message me on Facebook, and I'll make sure you get the information.
Okay, and your CD, In My Dreams, is available on that website also.
Absolutely, yes. I'm glad you mentioned that. I've done two solo albums in the last 5 years, one called It's a Pittsburgh Thing, which is a rocker, and the other one is In My Dreams, and it's really getting a lot of play, and I appreciate that very much. Thanks for mentioning it.
My pleasure. Now, if you would introduce I Think We're Alone Now, we will do it.
Okay. Again, a song written by Bo Gentry and Richie Cordell. This song is sung by Ronnie Rossman and I, and it'll be the third big hit of I Think We're Alone Now. First one by Tommy James and Shondells, then by Tiffany, and now by the Crystal Blue Band. Here we go.
Children behave. How you play it.
at the way we gotta hide what we're doing. 'Cause what would they say if they ever knew? And so we're running just as fast as we can, holding on to one another's hand, trying to get away into the night. And then you put your arm around me as we tumble to the ground. And then you say, I think we're alone now. There doesn't seem to be anyone around now. I think we're alone now. The beating of our hearts is the only sound.
Crystal Blue Band, and I think we're alone now. Mike, it sounds awfully good.
I appreciate that. We're excited.
For all of our veterans out there, this is for you.
Gentlemen and ladies, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate you. You know, we're sitting here today enjoying music and enjoying the great things of life, and it's all because of what you did and the price you paid, some ultimately. And we just love you. We thank you very much for your service.
That's endless. Your bravery we cherish. Thanks for your service. Thanks for your service. You are our heroes. Good souls never perish. Thanks for your service. Thanks for your service. Thanks for your service.